Welcome to Your Berks History, Berks History Center's February BCTV program. My name is Alexis and your host for this show. Today I am joined by two special guests, Brian Engelhardt and Barry Miller, and we're going to be talking about a special program that they're having this month for the Berks History Center's Second Saturday program. Berks History Center Museum is open Tuesday through Friday, 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. and Saturday, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. and is located at the corner of 940 Center Avenue, and that's the corner of Center Avenue and Spring Street. The Berks History Center Research Library is open Wednesday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., and Saturday, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m., and is located across the street from the Berks History Center Museum at 160 Spring Street. You can help to preserve your Berks County history by becoming a member to the Berks History Center. Included in your membership is free admission to the museum and research library, free admission to our exhibits, and for individual members and above, four issues of our quarterly magazine, The Historical Review of Berks County. You can join online by visiting berkshistory.org or giving us a call at 610-375-4375. If you like watching BCTV programs like Your Berks History, I encourage you to support BCTV. Any amount helps, and to support BCTV, you can mail your check to BCTV at 1900 North 13th Street, Reading, PA 19604. So welcome. We have our special guests today, Brian Engelhardt and Barry Miller. Brian and Barry, and particularly Barry, are going to be speaking at our February program, which is our February 2nd Saturday program on the 9th. And the title of that program is called Bloody Spring, Degler Chest, and the Hochstetler Massacres. And before we get into that, let's just meet you guys a little bit and get to know how you got involved in this program and this subject matter. Barry, you're a historian, or at least a
amateur historian.
A person that really enjoys Berks County's history, and you've done a lot of research here in the library, is that correct?
That's right. Yeah, this is kind of home base. There are a number of reasons that I'm interested. Number one, I grew up in the Midwest, and the history is totally different. I've always been interested in histories. When I came here, there were so many things to learn, and one of the first names I heard was Conrad Weiser, and growing up in the Midwest, we were never exposed to any information about him. Mm-hmm. And the more I got into his life and his involvement, the more it took me in the direction of the French and Indian War. Mm-hmm. And then ultimately, my wife and I moved from Reading to Upper Topohokan Township, and now we're within walking distance of Fort Northkill, of the Degler Chest, mm-hmm. the Bloody Spring, and so.
So you're right there in the action.
That's right, and so I dig into it very deeply now.
Uh-huh. And Brian, also, you are a Berks County history enthusiast, and you've written a number of articles for the Historical Review of Berks County on baseball history and a number of other subjects. How did you get started and interested in history?
My grandfather got me interested and teaching me all about the Conway Cabal. well, that's later about that later. I've written a number of things for the Historical Review, and Barry and I have been friends for 40 years. I've always wanted to be like him when he grows up. Subject of his topic last year on Conrad Weiser, I found fascinating. And I asked if he needed help on this project. You asked me about getting a program started, and I said this would be your guy. And so we've worked together on putting this together.
Mm-hmm. So just a little bit of history about how this all came about. The Berks History Center gets contacted regularly from folks in the community who are interested, particularly in the Hochstetler Massacre. And besides a couple of historical review articles, we really don't have much history about that subject in our archives here. And so we said, you know, Brian, is there a way that we could do a program on this? Because we think it's an interesting topic and something that people would really like to hear about. And so that's when you contacted Barry, is that right?
Yeah, yeah. And they're very sparse articles in the, when I said, oh, good, they're about a page and a half long. And they're both from 1933 or thereabouts. Mm-hmm. So this, it cries out for some supplemental material. And Barry is working on an article that I'm assisting him with that will be in a future historical review.
Great.
It'll be excellent, won't it?
Absolutely.
Well, okay. We're thankful that you volunteered to do it, and we want to talk a little bit about the program and what that's going to be like. So let's set the stage a little bit. We're talking about the French and Indian War, right?
Yeah, actually, if you look at the advertisement for this, it says in the really small print up top, significant incidents in the French and Indian War. Massacre, massacre, massacre. And so, actually, we'll be talking about, obviously, the big print events, but we'll also be talking about the French and Indian War, which significant for Berks County. Barry and I are talking about this. This is the only war on North American soil, starting with back in the days when King Philip's War, Queen Anne's War, the Civil War. This is the only war in North American soil where there was actual bloodshed in Berks County. 150 people were killed in these various raids, and 150 people were kidnapped or thereabouts, just approximating, and by the Indians. And plus the cultural effect on Northern Berks, and I'll ask Barry to talk about that. These are very significant events to parts of the community up there and certain religions as well. You could talk about that, Barry.
Well, I think the most basic reason that it's of importance to people in Berks County, so many of the families here are descended from the original settlers in the Tulpehockan settlement.
Mm-hmm.
And who then very rapidly, within the next decade or so, after 1723, spread northward, and by the time of the French and Indian War, populated the area below the Blue Mountain. So many of those families are still present and can trace their roots back mm-hmm. to names that appear in the histories of 1755.
Mm-hmm. So significant to many people in our community today.
They are.
Yep. It's their family history.
They are, very mm-hmm. much so. And with respect to the Hochstetlers in particular, there's a whole Amish tradition mm-hmm. that's related to the Hochstetler Massacre, which we can get into. But it's the idea of the peaceable people, and in this case, the irony of the peaceable people. And this is not the only instance that we'll talk about, but the peaceable people becoming victims mm-hmm. in the French and Indian War.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost the idea of the search for the guilty and the punishment of the innocent. This is mm-hmm. what happened in the case of the Hochstetlers.
Hmm. So in this instance, you're maybe talking about some folks that weren't directly involved in the conflict and were kind of trying to stay out of it, got involved in some bloodshed, or how does that work?
Well, basically, they were attacked at
mm-hmm.
home.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And there, one of the things that will come out in this whole presentation, there are a variety of stories surrounding individual events, because in the retelling from one generation to the next, you get some interesting variations, put it that way.
Sure.
We'll be discussing them.
Okay.
And perhaps, and this may be the opportunity for some people to affect written history, because if they come with documentation or come with a particularly good family story related to the Hochstetler massacre or the Kobel massacre or the abduction of the France family or the Bloody Spring or the Degler Chest, that will go into a review article that will be a follow-up to this presentation.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
So we're hoping some.
So we're building a history here within our coffers.
Very much.
If you go into the courthouse and you walk from the old courthouse to the annex on the second floor hallway, there's a display which I walked past for years. And that display is Indian massacres in Berks County. And I actually thought this was related to one of these. Well, it is a display that is tied into people that were killed and their estates were opened with codes that they died from wounds in Indian massacres. We looked into this and there one of the estates ties into this, but it's part of our legal history in Berks County as well. This was put up in 1990 and there's dust on it, but in any event, so that part of local culture also has tied into this, that being a part of our courthouse.
Sure. Before we go any further, can we just, I just want to clarify for folks that are listening at home, maybe you're confused about our usage of the word Indians versus Native Americans. And just for the purposes of this program and probably also for your talk, you are going to hear us using the term Indians to refer to Native Americans in this context. Can you explain a little bit about that and your decisions behind that?
Well, that was the term used at that time. All of the literature, all of the correspondence referred to Indians, rarely by their tribal or nation name. Actually, much of the correspondence was related to Christians and Indians. The white folks were considered Christians, and the Indians were called Indians. In talking with several representatives of Native American organizations and nations, I was told, you can call us anything you want, as long as it's done with respect. And that's a very important point. And I know that there's a lot of controversy surrounding the term Indian, but then should the term be Native? Should it be First Nations, the way it is in Canada? Should it be Indigenous people? There are so many different ways, but I think there's a certain wisdom in the statement that I was told.
Sure.
As long as it's done with respect.
Yeah.
Tribal name is really the preferred way. It's much better to refer to the Lenape, also known as the Delawares, the Lenape, or the Iroquois, or specific Iroquois like the Mohawk. That's really the preferred way among the nations today.
Thank you for explaining that. So Conrad Weisart definitely played a role in this whole story. Can you explain a little bit about that?
Why don't you talk a little bit about
that?
He's your boy.
Okay. Yeah. I'm a big admirer of Conrad Weisart. I truly am. At the same time, it's important that he not be granted sainthood, which is often the case, because it's so often stated that he was a friend of the colonist and friend of the Indians. Well, realistically, he was caught up in some major historical events that caused him to have to choose between the Iroquois and the Lenape. And the Lenape were the nation loosely used here because they actually were small groups. They were not organized the same way that the Iroquois were. They were the first people that William Penn signed his agreement with. He was the one they were the ones who welcomed William Penn to this area. So in the early days of William Penn, they were the most respected among the native peoples. However, as things evolved, especially in conflicts between the English and the French, the Iroquois became the pivotal group of the five nations of the, and then ultimately six nations of the Iroquois. So in effect, he had to just run over or allow the Iroquois and the white settlers to run over the Lenape. I don't think for him it was a terribly difficult choice because he was very much inclined to the Iroquois in the first place, and they didn't have a real high regard for the Lenape.
You talked about the attacks on the settlements. What I found interesting as I learned and researched this was that the Lenape or Delawares, they're the same nation. They lived in Ohio. The perps of these massacres were they left Pennsylvania. They were upset with the way they were treated and went to Ohio.
The Ohio Valley.
Oh, I'm sorry, the Ohio, okay. They then sulked, and then the French said, hey, if you want to go and attack them, we will feed your squaws and children while you go and attack. And they traveled back to their homeland and worked in these small raiding bands on isolated settlements, and that was the MO. Not big forts or anything like that. So, but that's what the basis of the attacks were. Guerrilla warfare.
Yeah, in Berks County, it was almost all the so-called Western Delawares or the Western Lenape,
okay,
who had moved gradually up the Schuylkill into the Tulpehocken and then were forced out when the Germans came down from Schoharie, from Conrad Weiser's relatives and then Conrad Weiser himself a few years later. They all then went west into basically the Pittsburgh area and westward, sort of very close to the Ohio border. At the same time, some of the Lenape remained in eastern Pennsylvania, north of the Allentown area. And they, the raids in that area were primarily from the Muncie, where they were a subgroup of the Lenape, came down and attacked that area. This area was attacked by people who came on foot all the way from the Ohio Valley.
Wow.
And as Brian said, they had all the motivation in the world for making the attacks in terms of their grievances and being forced out of their territory. At the same time, they did require some form of support from elsewhere, and the French provided that support. Because by that time, after two or three generations after William Penn, almost four generations after William Penn, they had adopted a lot of European ways, and they needed the supplies and the gunpowder, the guns, and of course for the food to feed their families while they were, instead of hunting, while they were out committing, you know, what were considered atrocities, of course, by the victims, considered a form of proper vengeance.
Sure.
By them.
Yeah.
The other thing they did was they would kidnap women and children and some older young men, but it was viewed as a very practical way to replenish their tribes for people losses that had been casualties of disease and women dying in childbirth. So they were rather coldly replenishing the female population that way. Ultimately, many times the kidnapped people would be ultimately ransomed back, but that wasn't always the case. So anyway.
So in some cases, would people end up sort of living with the tribes and kind of integrating in?
Yeah, that was a real issue at the very end of the French and Indian War, when because there were different phases of the war outside of Pennsylvania, and it didn't really, strictly speaking, end until 1763, following Pontiac's Rebellion. Up until that point, a number of the captives had remained in the Delaware or Lenape villages, or were actually traded, if you will, to some other nations. And when it came time, after 3, 4, 5, 6 years in captivity, many of the individuals had done exactly as you say. Mm-hmm. They had integrated themselves into the community, mm-hmm. and especially the young, you know, say a 10-year-old,
sure.
who had, was now 17 and had learned all of the native ways, it was very difficult for many of them to come back.
Yeah, that's interesting.
The hot part of the French and Indian War ended for Pennsylvania purposes in 1758 when Forbes took Fort Duquesne. On the North American continent, in 1759, Quebec fell and Montreal surrendered in 1760. So there was 3 more years of the 7 Years' War, as the 12-year period of time is often referred to, where things were going on elsewhere in the world, but things, for all intents and purposes, were settled here, as Barry said.
Mm-hmm. Just one point to pick up on. Here in Berks County, and particularly in northern Berks County, all of what was going on in this world war, which was known as the 7 Years' War in Europe, was somewhere else. You figure these are subsistence farmers trying to grow enough to support their family, mm-hmm. and perhaps have a little bit left over to sell, although there was very little selling or bartering that early in northern Berks. And so all this other business that they were caught up in was something that they really didn't know much about and care much about. What they were most interested in, obviously, was the family and then the children telling the family history. And that's kind of back to where we are.
Yeah.
That we will emphasize within the context that we're talking about. Maybe this is too much of a history lesson for some folks, but we're going to emphasize the family stories. We're going to emphasize the research that supports those stories, mm-hmm. the research that suggests that maybe the stories aren't entirely accurate, and we're going to concentrate on really 5 that I mentioned, plus also a mention of a Quaker family that was massacred mm-hmm. in 1763 during the Pontiac's Rebellion.
And what are the groups that you're going to be discussing at the program, the attacks that specifically?
Well, as you mentioned before, the Hochstetler massacre mm-hmm. would probably rank at the top in terms of, among other things, what is known.
We have a woodcut of that, which you can show on the screen.
Sure, yeah.
A woodcut of a kind. You know, it's the representations after the fact were not always mm-hmm. entirely accurate, mm-hmm. but it gives a pretty good picture, at least.
Right.
The Hochstetler massacre, more written about that and more known about that, and it's more of a tradition because the Amish have kept that at the forefront of the colonial experience. Hmm. The Degler chest, which has
a pretty interesting history from what I understand.
I'm
looking forward to learning more about that at the program.
Yeah, you know, the Degler chest, which was connected with the Bloody Spring. There's an area where more research needs to be done to support the information that's out there, because there's not a lot of historical documentation. And so if people can come forth with stories, that would be very much appreciated.
Oh, sure. Yeah, that would be great.
And then the Coble massacre in Bethel Township was during the very first attack in Berks County. And the France abductions in almost the same area was at the very end in 1758.
Mm-hmm.
Then we'll also look at the Fincher killings in 1763, and that was a Quaker family, and it was a story that based in apparently very good fact that was very similar to the Hochstetler massacre.
Mm-hmm.
Again, peaceful people expecting not to be caught up in this, but becoming victims of the war.
And that was part of Pontiac. That was part of Pontiac's rebellion, right?
That's right.
And Pontiac was an Indian chief near Detroit. Mm-hmm. And this was kind of a surprise at the end of the French and Indian War that he got upset. And if you could elaborate a little bit on that.
Well, he had good reasons to be upset, because at the end of the Pennsylvania phase of the French and Indian War, General Forbes, who led the expedition that in turn led to the fall of the French Fort Duquesne and the exit of the French from what is now Pennsylvania. General Forbes had made promises which were carried back by Piscataman, for that matter, the very guy who was out to get Conrad Weiser, by him and by Christian Post, with the assurance that they were, that the English would not go beyond the Alleghenies. In fact, then General Forbes died on the way back from the expedition, and Lord Geoffrey Amherst took over, and he was the one who authorized the circulation of smallpox blankets to,
wow,
to the native tribes. He had very little regard for any of the natives, and as a result, he broke the agreement, which very much angered Pontiac, even because the Western tribes were, could see the same thing happening to them that had happened to the Lenape and to the Shawnee. So in anger, he got a huge confederation together, actually destroyed many English forts, and the Delaware and the Lenape made this one more foray into Berks. And it was a total surprise, and it was panic all over again. That's one of the things that we will emphasize, is the effect that this had on the people. I mean, as you can imagine, when you're out there on your farmstead, separated by roughly a quarter mile from the next person, with your family.
Sure.
And usually a relatively small number, 6, 8, 10 of the adversaries, some armed with rifles and some with tomahawks, suddenly showed up at your door. That was time for great concern, especially when you knew the story of what had happened to your neighbors.
If you've ever seen The Searchers, the picture with John Wayne, one of the few pictures that he actually acts in, the first scene is an attack on John Wayne's extended family. John Wayne's not there. And it's the isolated feeling. John Ford does a great job of capturing how isolated you feel. So.
It sounds like you have a fascinating program that you're going to share with us at our next Second Saturday program. So we thank you so much for coming and sharing all that information with our viewers here on BCTV.
The date is February 9th.
February 9th. Did I mispronounce it earlier?
No.
Okay.
No, you didn't.
Great.
You didn't.
Great.
You said Second Saturday.
Yep.
And I don't have a calendar in my head, but
February
it's February 9th.
Yep.
Okay,
yep.
Good.
That's
I'll
the
be
date.
There.
I'm glad. And hopefully our viewers can join us as well. And like Barry said, if you have family stories, information you want to share with us, feel free to contact us at the Berks History Center, and we can get you in touch with Barry. It's 610-375-4375. Thanks. Or you can just come and chat with him at the program on Saturday on February 9th. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alexis.
We also hope you join us for our third annual Berks History Conference, which is on April 13th. From 9 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. And if, for those of you who don't know, our Berks History Conference is kind of an extended Second Saturday program where we bring in different speakers, particularly historians who have done a lot of research on specific topics. And this year we are going to be focusing on Civil War history. So for those of you who are Civil War buffs, this is really going to be a great opportunity. We have four speakers lined up for that day, and they're going to be sharing on different topics related to the Civil War and its connection to Berks County. So that's April 13th, and for information on that, please visit our website, berkshistory.org, or give us a call at 610-375-4375. Also, 2019 is a big year for the Berks History Center. The Historical Society of Berks County was founded in July 1869, and it is our 150th anniversary this year. So we are going to be kicking off our 150th celebration in July of this year, and that will run until June of 2020. We'll be celebrating throughout the year with a number of different events and special offers for our membership and also for our followers of Berks History. So keep an eye out for that on social media. Also in the Historical Review, we're going to be sharing some special stories about our history. We're also going to be doing a special exhibit this year related to the 150th anniversary. So there's lots of exciting things to look forward to, and we hope that you join us for that. Thank you so much for joining us for this episode of Your Berks History. And if you'd like to learn more about the Berks History Center or come visit us, you can follow us on social media at Berks History. Visit our website, www.berkshistory.org, or give us a call at 610-375-4375. And thanks so much, and we'll see you next month.